motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivated. Flow of wisdom on the mic with Sean.
Yes, I hope you all are motivated. Thank you for sticking around. Hour two of Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. This is part two of a series called The Boule, Steve Coakley, and The Roundtable. So much information covered so far, and so much more to dive into as we continue this series on The Boule. But like I told you, I promised I will open up the phone lines for phone calls at 1-877-300-7645. We have Don in Ohio wants to talk about The Boule and the Illuminati. Don, welcome to Flow of Wisdom. How are you?
Oh, fine. How are you? How are you? You know, first I'd like to say, I have to look at this as in a biblical perspective. You know, as the Bible says, we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in higher places, mm-hmm. and everything that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people who get the invite to the Illuminati group, and I know you were asking the question about, you know, you can see how these people who are prominent folk could join in with skull and bones. People fascinated with power and becoming part of being this elite group. Even in our modern day times, Oprah's had an invite to the Illuminati. And there's some information that even Snoop Dogg has been invited to the Illuminati. Because these people exist. You know, they're power hungry. They think that they have the right to rule over the rest of us because of some divine spark that they have that God allowed them to get their wealth. So they think they can make decisions for the rest of us. I had a book that I purchased back in the 80s, and I've only read one paragraph out of that book, and it was a quote by Prince Charles. And Prince Charles said this: government and corporations should make all the decisions for society. Now, that doesn't sound like a democracy. Mm-hmm. That's a one-world government. And that's what these people are hell-bent on establishing. And the Bible bears us out. If I didn't know what the Bible said, I would probably look at all this and say, not what you're saying, because I've heard this for years and years before, that this is all like this conspiracy theory. But the Bible talks about a one-world government, and it talks about a one-world church. It talks about the seat of the beast, which is the government, the beast or the Antichrist, which is the man that will lead it. It talks about a one-world church in which he would use this one-world church to solidify his power, and then he would turn around and destroy that religious element and demand that he would be worshipped as being God. And all these people have thrown their lots in with the devil. But what they don't know, they haven't read it, what it says in Revelation 11 chapter, that all those that destroy the earth, God will destroy. And that's all this is. These people have bought into something because many of these folk are Luciferian. They're witches and warlocks. Some of them think that they're old souls. Some of them think that they come from another planet. I happen to have met a gentleman in the 70s that was an executive at Avon, and he became a born-again Christian. His name was Billy Swain, very well-known evangelist from Tifton, Georgia. You can look his information up. And I heard this man in southern Georgia, he was running a crusade, and what he was preaching on was the Illuminati. And what he said was that a lot of people don't know, a lot of these heads of corporations, how they are witches and warlocks, because he said, I was one. It was in my family for generations. I was a warlock. My mother was a witch. It's been in our family for years. And this man became a born-again Christian, so he started to divulge and inform people about what was going on. He had three contracts that was out on his life that they had vowed to kill him because of what he knew. Mm-hmm. So this has been around a long time. And I also heard another gentleman years ago, he said there's a leak inside this group. And there are some people who are in the group who don't agree with what they're doing because they have like a 25-year plan on everything. And people kept wondering, like, how is it that you keep knowing what's going on? We don't understand this. You said this 10 years ago, and it happened. Because this guy said there's somebody inside there that he's not with them. And he leaks the information to this gentleman. I can't remember what his name was, but I heard him on a program one night for about 3 hours, and he was talking about all this. And the things that he was saying, we could see it in our society was happening. But this is what these people are hell-bent on doing. And like I said, they don't realize that they've thrown their lot in with Satan, but they will be destroyed. As far as with this, the group that you're talking about, I look at them as just being a way to control the black people.
Right.
You know, they had to have a leg of, like, how are we going to control the black population? See, like, they're like the sheep herders, and the rest of us are supposed to be just the pathetic sheeple. See, and a lot of people don't realize, as I said, they don't know what they have made themselves a part of, but they won't win. Whether they're the bankers, there's a book you can get out of history, it's called Dynasty, because many of these people are heads of state. And in this book called Dynasty, it names all these heads of state going back centuries, like the Habsburgs of Austria, the Bonapartes of France. And all these people, when these nations became democratic, or where the people wanted to get away from the monarchy, these people were hell-bent on holding on to power. They were a part of these secret organizations, because just like you talk about the Gilderbergs, right? Well, that's the Royal Dutch family. And the Royal Dutch family are the ones that own Shell Oil. Then we got the British, Royal British family. They're the ones that own BP. See? These people are hell-bent on hanging on to power. And the rest of us, we're just a pawn in their game.
Right. But, you know, knowledge is, it can be liberating, you know, and that's what I want to, that's one of the goals I want to accomplish. But you hit the nail on the head, Don. I mean, you're so right, man. You know, a lot of them are struck on the materialism and the financial gain and prosperity, because from my understanding, this is what they're promised when they come into this organization, when they founded, you know, they set it up. They'll be prosperous, you know, and they'll be promised, you know, wealth and fame and all of these worldly things that, you know, that appeases the flesh, you know. And I do understand that this is not a battle of flesh and blood. It is a spiritual battle against principalities. But yeah, man, you're well informed, it sounds. So I'm glad you called and shared.
Well, I like to also bring this up, because another thing these groups are hell bent on is, and you probably noticed too, reducing the population. And there's an interview that you can go to with Mr. Ted Turner, because he's a part of this also. And it's with the gentleman that took what's the guy's name? He used to be on CNN, the old guy. I can't think of his name right now. He used to do all the interviews. Mm-hmm. He retired. He was replaced with this British guy. Anyway, there's an interview that people can pull up on YouTube, and Ted Turner's on there. And one question this guy asked him was this. He said, well, you know, all the tragedies that are going on in the world and the famines and different things. And Ted Turner said this. Well, the problem is with the world is that it's overpopulated. Mm-hmm. So he asked him and said, well, what do you mean by that? It's overpopulated. He said, well, there's just too many people on the planet. And the indication is, you know, their number, their target number is 300 million people.
Yeah.
Now, there's over 7 billion people on the planet, right?
Yeah.
300 million people. A lot of these famines that are going on in the world are man-made.
Absolutely.
They could help these people, such as right there in Africa right now, it's like three nations together, 14 million people are facing starvation and death. The children get one meal a day in one nation, and that's when they go to school, and that's it. One country needs $27 million would save this nation, and the funds in the world that's supposed to be helping them, they say, well, we're strapped now, and there's just so many people that we have to try to feed, so they're not helping us. So they're willing to let 14 million people just die off.
You know, Don, I posed that question a couple of weeks ago on my show. Like, how is it that you have the richest continent on the planet Earth, the richest, but yet you have millions of people, like you say, starving, millions of people with disease. And there's no way that you can convince me that this isn't strategically implemented on people. You know, and I remember a few years ago, many years ago on my show, a guy called in on the show and was like, because the Ted Turner thing, that's going back to the Georgia Guidestones, their little quote unquote, their little funky commandments or what have you, you know, to get the total population into what they call perpetual balance. I thought it was 500 million. You mentioned 300 million, give or take. It's around the same. Right. They want to decrease the population, bottom line, in the story. But a caller called in and was like, Sean, the world is getting overpopulated, and I really don't see anything wrong with that. I was like, man, are you kidding me? There's untouched land on Earth. There's abandoned homes here in America. We waste more food in this country alone than we probably consume. You know, it just baffled. You cannot buy into that ideology thinking that the planet is overpopulated. I mean,
Well, you know something? I was working with a young man in the 80s. He was going to college. He was in ROTC, and he was taking sociology. And he posed this question to me. He said, if there's a natural disaster, such as what's going on in Ethiopia at the time, he said, would it be right for us to intervene to help these people? Or is this Mother Nature's way of keeping the planet from being overpopulated? And, of course, my answer was this. Well, that would be morally wrong just to let these people starve. He said, no. He said, no, it's Mother Nature's way of keeping the planet from being overpopulated. And I asked him, I said, where did you get that from? He said, well, my sociology class. They are training a whole generation to be insensitive.
Mm-hmm.
See, mm-hmm. It is like you're saying, it's by design.
Yep, it is by design. Don, great call. Thank you so much, man. And don't hesitate to call in again, man. I got to take a quick commercial break. That's Don in Ohio. Good insight. Look, we got more on the Boule. Los Angeles Times article written in 1990. I'm going to share it with you in just a few minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Floor of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony, and thank you so much for listening. People are checking me out, man, live on GCNLive.com. It's one of the top shows streaming live right now, so I thank you, everyone that's listening online. My website is flowofwisdom.com. The toll-free number is 877-300-7645. That's 877-300-7645. Before I get into this article that I've been telling you about that was published in the LA Times in 1990, I want to ask you this question rhetorically. Who is Charles Wesley? Who is Charles Wesley? Now, I know that some of the alphas out there may be listening, that name may ring a bell to you, and I'm sure it should if you are a member of Alpha Phi Alpha. Charles Wesley, to the alphas, they know him as the man that wrote the history book on Alpha Phi Alpha. But did you know, my dear brothers of Alpha Phi Alpha, that Charles Wesley also wrote the history book for the Sigma Pi Phi, or shall we say the Boule? Well, who is Charles Wesley? Briefly, he was born in Louisville, Kentucky. He attended local schools as a boy, went on to graduate in 1911 from Fisk University, a historically black college in Nashville. He earned his master's from Yale University in 1913, continued with his graduate work in 1925. Wesley became the fourth African-American to receive a Ph.D. from Harvard University. He was awarded a Doctor of Divinity in 1928 by Wilberforce University. He also became an ordained minister in African Methodist Episcopal Church, AME. He also had an academic career as a professor of history, and wrote a total of more than 15 books on African-American history and political science. He served as the dean of the Liberal Arts and Graduate School of Howard University. In 1942, he was called as president of Wilberforce University. an AME-affiliated university in Wilberforce, Ohio, serving until 1947. That year, he founded Central State University across the street from Wilberforce, and that's the university that I went to. He served as its president until 1965, and then he became, returned to Washington, D.C. Later on, he was elected as the 14th and a five-term general president and later national historian for 7 decades of Alpha Phi Alpha, which is the first intercollegiate Greek letter fraternity established by and for African Americans. The book was called The History of Alpha Phi Alpha. It was published in 1929, updating it many new editions. But he was also an archon of Sigma Pi Phi. He was also a Prince Hall Freemason, a sovereign Grand Inspector General, 33rd degree, of the United Supreme Council, the Southern Jurisdiction, Prince Hall, a member of the Odd Fellows, Elks, and many other fraternal organizations. Wesley died in 1987 in D.C., and he was buried at the Lincoln Memorial in Maryland. But quite a fascinating resume, a very prominent, brilliant man, and did a lot of great things, I'm certain. But some information that probably many of us did not know in his affiliation with the Boule. So here we are. Again, I just keep thinking back to that conversation I had with my friend. He's like, man, this sounds great. This sounds really good. Why, you know, I want to be in the Boule, he said. And I thought that that was interesting because I asked Steve Coakley, is it okay to be in the Boule? What's wrong with that? These prominent men, they do so many fantastic things. Why not? And this is what Steve Coakley had to say in response.
Anytime a person takes an oath, whether it be as a Delta or a Zeta or an AKA or a Mason or a Guardsman or a Boule or a Skull and Bone, anytime you take an oath, you give allegiance to your organization above and beyond your loyalty to your family.
Stop right there. We got to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, I'm going to play the rest of this excerpt asking Steve Coakley, is it okay to be in the Boule? And then I'm going to read that article that was published in the LA Times back in 1990 on the Boule. Let's roll with it. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Flow of Wisdom Radio live here. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. Toll free 1-877-300-7645. I'm going to play back this clip again of Steve Coakley when I asked him, what's wrong with the Boule? Why is it wrong for black men to join Sigma Pi Phi? What's wrong with that? Or even the Freemasons or any kind of organization? And listen to Steve Coakley's response when I asked him that.
Anytime a person takes an oath, whether it be as a Delta or a Zeta or an AKA or a Mason or a Guardsman or a Boule or a Skull and Bone, anytime you take an oath, you give allegiance to your organization above and beyond your loyalty to your family. And an example I always give is that Leroy goes to become a Mason and does the ritual. And his woman, who's been married to him for 30 years, been there through sickness and in health, in poorness and in wealth, he comes home and she says, what happened at that lodge today? And he says, I can't tell you. So the loyalty to his woman is longer and more intense than his relationship with the Masonic people he met only earlier that day. And the first unit of organization is the family, anything at any time that can separate the welding of the family is a danger to community.
A danger to community. The voice of Steve Coakley. May he rest in peace. We lost Steve Coakley a few years ago. And I think I had one of the last few interviews at this kind of this platform with Brother Steve. He's done thousands of lectures. He's researched so much information. And just talking to him, he spews this information out with his eyes closed. Please look him up, look into him, and let's you know, keep his legacy going, because what he contributed to black people is just informing us and teaching us. Learn, you know, so we can learn the history and you know, connect the dots on these organizations. All right, now back to what I was telling you about this article in the LA Times that came out in 1990. The exact date is July 18th, and the title of the article, July 18th, 1990, Karen Grigsby Bates wrote this article, Elite Fraternity Widens Agenda for Black Men. Organizations at the prompting of a younger generation, the prosperous and prominent members of the once secret Boule are focusing more on social activism. When the NAACP's conference ended here last week, civil rights leaders left behind a portrait of black men in crisis. Too many young black men, said the civil rights group, are underemployed, alternately feared and reviled, and living at risk. Now come the men of Sigma Pi Phi, a once secret black fraternity that celebrates the professional and material success of black men, known as the Boule, pronounced Boule. And for those that are listening, it's spelled B-O-U-L-E, Boule. The group is here this week for its biennial meeting and its own look at, quote, an agenda for the black male in the 1990s. It was an invitation-only tuxedoed gathering of some of the most prominent and powerful black men in America, who say they are struggling to define their responsibility to other black men, the ones the NAACP calls endangered. Boule is a Greek word designated a council of community leaders who advised kings. The reference members of the 3,000-man worldwide fraternity is highly intentional. This is the article. They're telling you, the LA Times, that the Boule is a Greek word, which means a council of community leaders who advised kings. Anyway, reading on, the roster of members here this week reads like a who's who among blacks. United States Secretary of Health and Human Services, Louis W. Sullivan. Democratic National Committee Chairman, Ron Brown. Mayor Tom Bradley, NAACP Executive Director Benjamin Hooks. Like Yale's Skull and Bones secret society, to which George Bush belongs, the Boule has been criticized by some as a social anachronism and has challenged members to change its image. Incoming President Dr. Benjamin Major, a retired San Francisco physician, said he is aware of charges that the group is more interested in socializing and congratulating itself on its inviolable exclusivity than it is making a substantial contribution to the rest of black America. Until 8 or 10 years ago, we were just what we were perceived to be, said Major, who wants to make the group's Social Action Committee more aggressive. So real quick, here this article is telling you, and this gentleman, Mr. Major, Dr. Major, he confirmed the fact that this organization, up until this point, from my understanding, weren't really looking out for the best interests of the rest of black folk in America, if you will. Now, let's just take it back to that time frame. We're talking about the late 80s and going into the 90s. See, I was young during that time, so I was aware of the culture that was going on at that time. You know what was preached often? We heard repetitively as a young black child, a teenager, back in the late 80s, 90s. You know what we kept hearing? You'll be lucky to make it past 25 years old. That's what they kept telling us. That's all we kept hearing. You'll be lucky to make it past 25. This was around the time when gangster rap started to emerge. Corporate America, corporate funding started to get behind gangster rap. Behind the scenes, you may not have seen it on the front lines, but trust me, they got behind it and pushed it and pushed it and pushed it. On top of that, you take the deliberate dumbing down of America as a, it's a title of a book. Check that book out as well. You incorporate that with the systematic cutting off the resources in ghettos across the country, all of that stuff, man. And the government or CIA pumping in crack, cocaine, heroin in all the black neighborhoods across the country. They're importing guns all across black neighborhoods, all across the country. You think about that for a minute. And, you know, some people on the outside looking in thinking like, you know, you black people, man, y'all need to get it together. Stop doing the drugs. Stop selling the drugs. Stop selling the crack. Stop shooting each other. But look, you got to understand systematically when you take away resources, you strategically take away resources. And you put these different things inside walls, a virtual prison. You're going to have all kind of outcry. Now heroin's hitting the suburbs. Now we have a national epidemic. Heroin has been in black neighborhoods for decades, but now it's a national epidemic. Because the heroin that got over on the other side of the railroad tracks. And look, by any means, I don't want to see anybody addicted to that stuff. I mean, anything, it's just bad. It's bad. But why wasn't it a national epidemic? Anyway, let me get back on track. it's so purposeful. It's so strategic. These people are brilliant. I mean, look at the people that I've mentioned so far already. It's just in the Sigma Gamma, not Sigma Gamma, but Sigma Pi Phi, Boule. These are brilliant people. Same thing with the Skull and Bones. These people aren't stupid at all, by no stretch of the imagination. But the question we must ask is, who are they serving? Who will you serve? Who are you serving? Back to the article. And this article clearly equates the Boule with the Skull and Bones. Clearly. And he recognized, Dr. Benjamin Major, he recognized the fact that they were not doing their part as far as, addressing the issue that's going on in black communities. He says, we don't want to appear as if we were remaining above the problems of most black people. We know we didn't get here solely by the dint of our own hard work, he added. We owe a lot of people, and we have to give back to our brothers and sisters. That's what he said. This ballroom that they met in South Central was about a freeway away. I'm sorry, this hallway, this ballroom that they met, this hotel, the Bonaventure Hotel, where they had their meeting at was only a freeway away from South Central Los Angeles. But the article says, but it was light years away in mood. As 1,300 members and wives skirted the buffet tables and to clasp hands and embrace, a black tie band played jazz favorites from the 40s and the 50s. The men looked prosperous and seemed accustomed to the difference accorded them. Many of their well-coiffed wives wore designer clothes, French perfume, and expensive-looking jewelry. The fact that the world of black men in crisis rarely collides with this world of black tie networking concerns some older Boule members, as well as many of the young achievers now being invited in. This was formed in 1904, guys. Still going strong. I'm going to finish, try to get through some more of this article here right after these quick messages. It's Flow of Wisdom Radio. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. We are live here every Sunday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, toll-free 877-300-7645. I want to get through some more of this article from the L.A. Times, published in 1990 at an event held by the Boule. And it's very interesting because, like I said to you before, there's prominent people. Like, these are the who's who that are in this organization. And like I said, it was formed in 1904 by a group of Philadelphia doctors and dentists. The fraternity was organized so that the tiny number of black men with graduate degrees could network with each other and help younger men. It was important back then, said Major. As a young man living in Berkeley, Major recalled that he would catch an occasional glimpse of older men in the community as they quietly left to attend their ritual monthly meetings. Quote, I saw these black professional men, doctors, judges, lawyers, put on their tuxedos every fourth Saturday and disappear, Major said. I wanted to know what was going on. He found out when he became one of the very few invited to join the group. He learned the secret handshakes and other Greek esoterica as he discovered that most of the black leaders in his community were already members. He says it was an honor to simply be in the company of such men. Elite fraternity widens agenda for black men. Organizations at the prompting of a younger generation, the prosperous and prominent members of the once secret Boule, are focusing more on social activism. Today's membership includes Virginia Governor Douglas Wilder. I had a side note. I had an opportunity to meet former Governor Douglas Wilder briefly. And from my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe he was the first black governor, if not in America, in, of course, the state of Virginia. But Douglas Wilder is a member because he's still alive. From understanding, yeah, member of the Boule, Chief Judge A. Leon Higginbotham, I think that's how you pronounce his name. He was of the U.S. Federal Court of Appeals in Philadelphia. Publishers Earl Graves, y'all heard of Black Enterprise magazine and that whole publication, Earl Graves, and John H. Johnson from Ebony magazine. And that whole platform, the list of deceased members reads like a page of modern American history. Sociologist W.E.B. Du Bois, which you heard Steve Coakley mention in the excerpt that I shared. U.N. Ambassador Ralph Bunche. Urban League President Whitney Young. The Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And his legendary mentor, Dr. Benjamin Mays. Some of y'all are probably like, what? Dr. Martin Luther King was a member of the Boule? Yes, he was. And coming up on next week's show, I'm going to get some more intel, some more inside information on King and his affiliation with the Boule and kind of some things that kind of transpired with that. But I'll be sure to pick up on that on next week's show. Many past and present Boule members were first and onlys, according to Sigma Pi Phi historian Matthew Carter himself, the first black mayor of a predominantly white Montclair, New Jersey. Chemist Samuel P. Macy was the first black professor at the United States Naval Academy in Maryland. Ernest Wilkins, who received a Ph.D. at age 15, was the only black scientist attached to the Manhattan Project. Several of the fraternity's Los Angeles members are second-generation Boule brothers. Ivan Houston, chairman of Golden State Mutual Life Insurance Company, one of the country's largest black-owned insurance companies and co-chairman of the conference, followed in his footsteps of his father, Norman. Elbert Hudson was another legacy member. His father, H. Claude Hudson, a dentist and banker with a law degree, was president of the Los Angeles NAACP chapter. See, these are prominent people. And you probably know who many of these men are today. This article, what I just quoted, was 1990. So think about all the prominent black men that are in prestigious positions right now. More than likely, 8 times out of 10, maybe 9 times out of 10, they are a member of the Boule. I ran out of time. I hope you are enjoying the series. Please spread the word and tune back next Sunday, 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I got to run to a meeting, y'all. Live life, give wisdom, and let it flow. Peace.